All right, on this whip, I want to get a lot accomplished, so I'm going to kind of jump right into it and going to paint this wood right here. It's going to be a dark brown, and I kind of want to do that because I want to encase everything really well. Alright, I'm going to paint this section right here, terracotta, after we do some shades and different things on it, see how it turns out. But I just want to try. It's all about learning. Alright, now that we painted the brown, we even went with the brown over into the other section, just to tie it in. I just want to go right to here to illustrate that it's going to start from new, start a new section right here. Got the terracotta all painted, base color coat. Now we're going to do golden brown Mordor on this piece right here to show that it was installed at a different point in time than the rest of them. All right, now that all the colors are painted on, they're all dry, I'm going to start hitting with the Agrax Earthshade. I'm going to do all of them Agrax Earthshade, and then I might go back, depending on how it looks, I might go back and hit them with Nuln Oil in some locations, depends how dark I want it to be. So let's just start applying Agrax first. This is something I've done occasionally when I'm not quite happy with how dark it's making something, but this Agrax Earthshade isn't quite making it dark enough. But I just don't want to cover it entirely with Nuln Oil because I don't want it to be that color solid either. So what I'm doing is I'm letting this pool up in some areas to make it darker. It's just another technique to kind of give variation. But what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna come back and just with some Nuln Oil, kind of get a lot on there and just kind of drop it here and there, just to darken up some sections. I guess I've never explained dry brushing before, but I just use my old cloth that I've had for years, just an old shirt. I don't even know how old it is anymore. But I just use that to just remove most of the paint off my brush till I get to where I want. And I'm so used to it that this just works for me. Some people use paper towels. Some people use, there's a huge variety of ways you can do things. Now that the wood's all dry, we're gonna go over it with the dark brown just to kind of bring some of the color back. But I still wanna keep the dark in there as well. And then we'll move on to the next color after that, which we'll see how this turns out. And then if it turns out how I like, then I'll probably jump to gray. We'll start doing that. It doesn't look like much, but it did tone down the black a little bit when I went over with the brown. And now I'm gonna go over this tan part right here, or the lighter part, with a Bambi brown. It's a Delta Ceramcoat. I'm using a Citadel dry brush. On the orangish wood, or the terracotta wood, I'm gonna go back with the dark goldenrod. And try not to do too much on my brush. I'll try to get as much paint off of my brush as possible to start out with and to see how it turns out. I'm not too happy with the Bambi color over here. I think it kind of sucks, but I will try and recover that. At least in real life it does. I don't know how the camera's gonna translate it, but I'm not a fan. But it may turn out better when I start slapping some gray on it, but right now it's just not kind of that appealing. I'm gonna come back on the terracotta color with a maple sugar tan. Yeah, that's what it says. And just for kicks and giggles, I'm gonna probably just hit that just at a spot that I think I can recover just to see what it looks like, just to see if I can, there's a potential of recovering that color, at least the color I was going for. And sometimes I really don't know what the color is that I'm going for, but I just wanna see if I can mute that color a little bit more. All right, it looks like this color is gonna be able to recover the look I was going for on this wood right here, which makes me feel better because I really didn't like that other color. It didn't go well, but so we don't have a mixture, but still I like that color much better for what I was looking for. Let's go over on the terracotta side first, and I want to do it ever so light. Oop, that's way too much. My bad. Because this area right here is so dark, I'm gonna go with the storm gray, which is a darker gray, and just to start out on the safe side, just to bring it up. So I'm going to use the 80-20 rule. And so I think it was Vsauce or somebody way smarter than me that says, if like if you walk in your house, you walk only on 20% of the area most of the time. So the idea is I'm going to have a path that's going to lead from here. It's going to go down here because the ladder is going to be on the other section of the roadhouse. And that's where I'm going to have the most wear and tear on this, is there's going to be a path that's going to basically do what I'm the brush where I'm taking the brush right now. And that's going to be the 80-20 rule. So that's going to be my 20% line right there from that door down this way. Obviously other places will be worn, but this is the path that's going to be used the most because it takes it to this resident down to the ladder, which is on the other section. Okay, now we're going to jump to a Bridgeport gray and bring it up and try to be not have a lot of paint on my brush again, just so I don't bring this up too much. All right, that gives the look I want. I kind of wanted to feel like a someone's deck or porch that has wood on it and hasn't been. Well, it's just it's almost getting there to where it needs to be restained again, taken care of. But that's kind of the look I wanted, where it's you still see the original color underneath and some of the previous stain, but it's also starting to gray out a little bit. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to dry brush down the path with raw sienna. Just going to dry brush down here to show dirt and wear, and then later on when I do flocking and different things like that, I'll probably do a little bit more texturing when it's all done, so I can do it all at once. I don't want to do a lot, just want to give the indication that it's been traveled a lot. All right, now I'm gonna be painting the totem pole, and I'll be honest with you, I've never done something like this before. I don't want it to look like a freshly upkept totem pole. You might think it would, but once again, this is kind of the portion of the row house that someone really doesn't care as much as they probably should. So this is going to be an adventure. I'm going to see if I can pull it off. I have reference material, so I'll see if I can do it. But I'm going to start off with a soft gray and kind of outline some things and see how it goes and see if I can screw this up. Now we're going to go with Evil Sunz Scarlet. Because it's such a small area, I'm going to come back with a Troll Slayer Orange. Now I'm going to use a Warpstone Glow. Come back with a Moot Green for a highlight. Gonna come back with the Lothern Blue. Come back with rye yellow. I don't know how to pronounce that word. Gonna come back with black. I want more control on this one, so I'm coming back with the miniature brush, Winsor & Newton Series 7 that I normally paint my miniatures with. I want more control on this. Come back and do a little bit of touch up with soft gray, and I'm not gonna lie, that last segment sucked. Just yeah, that was all right. So the totem is done. I may work on it more because there's things that are bugging me about it. What I would recommend doing is, if you're going to do something like that, I would not attach it. But this was so long ago and I was doing it for different reasons. But that's a lesson learned. Yeah, don't attach something like that. It would have been a lot easier to paint not attached there. What I'm going to do is I'm going to hit the top and start painting some colors. And there's a lot of rugs up there that I put, but I want all the colors up there kind of muted. That so it doesn't really overpower and take over and look like a rainbow and just a jumbled mess up there. So they're just going to be kind of muted. So muted, holy cow. So the rest of the roadhouse will stand out more than up there. I'm going to use some Techless Blue first over here. This kind of tied in. So there's blue there over on the front and there's blue here. I don't want a lot of paint on my brush when I'm doing this. Kind of want to give it the a dappled feel, like there's it's dirty and not 100% clean, obviously, as I said dirty. So it's going to kind of stipple it. I'm going to come back with a Drakenhof Nightshade, but I want to really dilute it. I don't want it to be overpowering. I want it to be very thin, so I'm going to mix it with water. I'm going to do an Averland Sunset. I'm gonna go back with Seraphim Sepia. Now that this is dry, for the most part, I'm gonna come back with a Lothern Blue and just kind of bring some of it up. Then I'll check it out and see how it looks, and if I want to just maybe bring up a tad more, I might. But like I said, I don't want it to really pop up here. But I do want to show the texture better than it already is. Yeah, I think that's going to be plenty good. I like how Averland Sunset looks over on the other side of the row house. So I'm going to do this one right here, the same color, tie them together. So what I'm doing, I'm just coming back with water. And I'm just removing some of the paint, the extra paint that I wanted on there. Because I feel like this has had more dirt on it. And so I want that to kind of show through a little bit. And the yellow to kind of just give a hue to it. And where this doesn't look like it's nearly as covered up over here, we'll give a little bit stronger yellow. Behind the totem, I'm going to use a Genestealer Purple. And this is one of my really old Winsor & Newton brushes. They still have a purpose. I can still use them and still beat the tar out of them. And while I'm waiting for the purple to dry, I'm going to hit the pot up here with the terracotta and make it a terracotta color. Terracotta everywhere. This terracotta pot is a Hearst Arts mold, if you're wondering. I want to shade part of the pot with the Seraphim Sepia. Seraphim Sepia. Okay, there's one right here. I'm going to paint that one a warp stone glow. Glow? Yep. I'm going to hit this one with an Anthonian Camoshade. I'm not diluting this one because I like how it's applying, so I'm just going to leave it. Now that this is dry, I'm going to come back with Averland Sunset again just to kind of bring some of the higher points out a little bit more. I may not go higher than that, just because, like I said before. I'm going to hit this right here with the Druchii Violet, and I want to, Druchii Violet goes on pretty heavy, so I'm going to dilute it. All right, Evil Sun Scarlet's going to go on this one right here. I'm going to come back with Sepia again. And man, it's so hard to be enthusiastic or act like you're talking to somebody when you're trying to concentrate on this. If you ask my fellow painters, usually when I paint, I become quiet as a church mouse. I don't hardly say anything. So this is a breaking out of a major mold for me to actually try to talk while I'm doing this. Apparently I can't multitask very well, so maybe that's why I just don't talk when I'm painting. This is Warpstone Glow again, coming back on this one. But yeah, it makes it easy to all these different colors because I can just bounce around really fast because while I'm working on one, the other ones are drying. So that makes it nice. It's not a lot of time consuming. Well, it's time consuming because there's so many. And sometimes I wonder why I do some of the things I do, but what do you do? Coming back on here with Genestealer Purple, just like I've been doing, just come back with the original color, bring it up. I really don't want to bring them up any higher because I don't want them to, I want all the exaggeration to be on the bro houses themselves, and this more muted, more, I don't know, I guess you say realistic. Like if I was to do like a military diorama or something like that, or something military, I wouldn't have it kind of so cartoonish. Since the metal sections up here are kind of, there's something I've done in the past where I've just kind of dry brushed, stippled metal color on here. And that way it looks like it's rusted already because the brown's already on there. And I'm just kind of bringing out some of the metal color to give the illusion that it's a metal piece, mostly on the edges. Now I'm gonna come back with a little bit of mithril silver just to really hit the upper edges a little bit so it really drives that illusion home. Thanks for joining me on this Whip Wednesday. I'm glad you could make it, and I hope you learned something or you got something out of it. If nothing else, I hope you enjoyed it, and it was fun to do. And I'm not going to lie, there were times where it was taxing, and I wish I would have never mounted that totem pole to that piece because it was a nightmare. not really happy with it, but I don't really want to go back and fix it either. But not worried. I mean, it is what it is. If I get a wild bug later, I'll go back and fix it, but I'm not going to. On this one, there's a few things that are still left undone, like hinges, doorknobs. There's some of the front metal. I want to spend more time on it, but I was just, I got to take a minor break from the row house, just so I don't get burned out and I stay fresh. So I'm going to bounce to something else temporarily. Also the shields aren't done on the other row house section. And that's because I just did the wood on there just too tied in together. And that's why the rocks are done too. It's just so they're done at the same time. So they tie. So it's not dramatically different. So that's why Tyler pointed that out to me when I sent some pictures to him. I thought, I better explain that. That's why the shields aren't done. So that's where that's at. But the taco for today goes to Josh. He has a dog named Murphy. He's a young gamer and he goes frequently with his father up to our local game store, and he runs Sylvaneth, and he has a good time, and he keeps coming back, even though he gets thumped here and there, but he really likes it, and he has a good time, and he's funny. And one of the things he likes to do is I'm going to kind of rat him out a little bit. He likes to look for dice under the table, because there's about an inch and a half, 2-inch clearance under the bottom of the tables, because of the metal tables at this hobby store, and he goes under there and looks for dice, and it's like a treasure trove. It's actually kind of entertaining. And when he scores some dice, he's a pretty happy kid. But anyway, taco for today goes to Josh. And keep gaming. Keep having fun. And learn how to paint, too. You have a good teacher in your house. So learn how to paint. I think you'll have a good time. And so since I live near you, I owe you a taco. And you should get other people around you to buy you a taco, too, because it's probably going to be the best taco you've ever had. Anyway, I'm just going to call it a wrap on this one and call it good and move on to another project for a little bit, another whip, and then we'll bounce back to the row house again and take care of that. If you have any comments, questions, let me know below. If you like what you see, like our channel, subscribe to it, hit the notification bell, and I don't know. That's about it. So until next time, ciao.
Cool fire. Southern Mass.
You say sa, dude?
What?
Did you say
Southern Nights?
Sa, dude.